Ham Radio Now, episode 240. Wait a minute. Check the website. 241. That doesn't seem right. I think I've done something since then. Let me check YouTube. 244. Parity in Missouri. Yeah, I got some website updating to do. Oh, dear. In any case, Ham Radio Now, episode 245. Yeah, I know that's empty right now. I'm conflicted over the title. Well, the proper title should be House Subcommittee Passes Amateur Radio Parity Act. That's what the real news title ought to be. But the creative side of me wants this title. All parody, all the time. So, Ham Radio Now, episode 245. All parody, all the time. You can see who wins in a conflict like that. I am Gary Pierce, Scan4AQ. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the programs, get something out of them, stop by and see my buddy Arvin there, the chief financial officer for the operation at hamradionow.tv. Yeah, that's this right there, hamradionow.tv. And click the pig. Help us out. Got a Patreon going. You can click on a monthly basis. No, click once and support the program on a monthly basis. Okay, so let's not bury the lead. The House Energy and Commerce Committees, I can read that better. And so let's not bury the lead. The House Energy and Commerce Committee's Subcommittee on Communications and Technology voted early this morning to report the Amateur Radio Parity Act to the full committee. It means they voted to move it on. They said, yeah, good enough for us. Off you go to the full committee. And it was quick.
Subcommittee will come to order. At the conclusion of opening statements yesterday, the chair called up H.R. 1301, and the bill was open for amendment at any point. Are there any bipartisan amendments to the bill, H.R. 1301? Are there any amendments to H.R. 1301?
Mr. Chairman.
If not, I now recognize the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Kinzinger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to strike the last word.
Gentleman's recognized.
Mr. Chairman, for nearly three decades, a large segment of amateur radio operators have been prohibited from installing any form of functional antennas on their own homes due to land use restrictions. For those of you that do not know, amateur radio operators perform a number of vital functions to help establish communications for our first responders during disaster. When the rest of the communications infrastructure goes down due to a disaster, it is hams that are able to patch through communications for our first responders so that they're able to effectively communicate, which is a vital and life-saving function. As the FEMA director recently said, quote, "I think there's a tendency to believe we've done so much to build infrastructure and resiliency in all of our other systems that when everything else fails, amateur radio is oftentimes our last line of defense. When you need amateur radio, you really need them." It's important to note that when many of these regulations were first put into place, land use restrictions throughout the country were much less pervasive, but over time, these areas have become more and more prevalent, which is not necessarily a bad thing by any means, but just as we've done in our committee time and again, it's good to look back at laws and regulations that were put into place long ago to make sure that they're kept up to date with the ever-evolving pace of innovation and change. Over the past 30 years, while these other land use restrictions have been in place, the flip side of this issue and the basis for this legislation is that FCC policy requiring municipalities to reasonably accommodate the placement of antennas for amateur radio use has worked wonderfully. Antenna height, configuration, and aesthetics have been subject to municipal jurisdiction under the FCC's reasonable accommodation policy. The relationships that have been built on the basis of cooperation following these standards between the licensees, land use planners, and reasonable regulations has resulted in a process that retains the decision-making power to the municipalities while allowing amateur radio operators to have the equipment necessary to effectively complete their functions. This is exactly the model on which we put together this legislation, through a reasonable accommodation standard. There's nothing in this legislation that would prohibit the review or approval of amateur radio antennas before their placement, or to prohibit them in certain common areas. However, I do understand the concerns that have been brought forward by parties impacted by this legislation. I'd also like to thank those parties for their willingness to come forward to reach a consensus on this issue before we reach the full committee markup on the bill. I understand some scheduling issues prevented us from having new language for today's markup, but it's my sincere hope that we'll be able to work together to find a solution that works for everybody in this issue. And this is something, Mr. Chairman, that I think is very indicative of this committee, is our ability on both sides to come together and work through issues, sometimes as niche as this, but very important, and other times even bigger issues. So I appreciate the both sides of the aisle willing to work together on this. And I just want to make one more point. You know, as a military pilot, with some of the new technology, I remember flying, you know, back in 06, 07 overseas, and using amateur radio operators to pass messages. In some cases, it was encoded messages that nobody understood what they meant, but they were passed to our command post, which had a mission status, or sometimes you can even, in a very doomsday scenario, receive an encoded message from and through these operators. And lastly, they also do phone patches. If you want to call your mom back in Bloomington, Illinois, you can have these operators do a phone patch and do it through the radio. So personally, I have appreciated what they do from a very small perspective of just flying overseas with the military. And again, Mr. Chairman, I just want to thank everybody involved in helping to get this done, and I look forward to this bill passing. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman for his good work on this legislation and his time. Are there other members? Yes, I now recognize the gentlelady from California, Ms. Escher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank Mr. Kinzinger for his legislation. This is a bipartisan bill. You've worked hard on it, and it shows, because there are over 100 co-sponsors. So while we have some concerns about, you know, the bill having impacts on homeowners associations, I appreciate Chairman Walden saying that that we'll work this out, as you said, and so we're prepared to move this along with a voice vote. So thank you for your work, and I yield back.
Gentlelady yields back. I would move strike the last word. I feel like I have to say something, since I'm one of the only licensed amateur radio operators in the Congress. And I concur with what Mr. Kinzinger said. You know, it's not just in emergencies that amateur radio operators are active. I know my own hometown of Hood River, the radio amateurs of the Gorge are often active in helping communicate with communications during various community events, non-emergency events, the cross-channel swim. There are all kinds of bicycling competitions and all, mountain biking and all, where they will be the communications network to help facilitate safety in many cases for the runners or the swimmers and all that kind of communication. And then certainly when the lights go out and the power goes out and everything else goes down, many of these amateur radio operators then have their own generators. They have their own communication systems that are backed up by generators and perform that emergency communication. And in addition to just the voice communication, as you probably know, one of the best ways to get through when everything else fails is old Morse code, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I mean, you go through it, and that can get through when nothing else can. And so I think this is really important. And with today's technology and the different bands that amateur radio operators can operate on, you don't necessarily have to have a giant tower blocking everybody's view in a community living situation. Literally, you can get a 2-meter antenna that's probably a foot high, with a mag mount that you can put up on the roof or somewhere. And, you know, the Supreme Court has stepped in some of these cases for satellite communication. There was a period of time when they tried to blanket prohibit little satellite dishes in these home situations. And the court came in and said, you know, for television, you can't just have a blanket ban. We think the same should apply to amateur radio, that certainly there can be some reasonable prohibitions, but a blanket ban is probably shouldn't be legal, and B really takes away an emergency communication tool that, frankly, in the case of a tornado or a hurricane or a flood or something, people in those homeowners associations may be glad they got a ham radio operator next door that can fire up their rig and communicate and get a signal out when everything else fails. So I congratulate the gentleman for his work on this legislation. I encourage the parties who are still negotiating out there, get your work done sooner rather than later, because we intend to move this bill in full committee and get it across the House floor soon. So we appreciate the good faith negotiations that have gone on. We look forward to those coming to a conclusion sooner rather than later, because I think there's common ground that can be achieved here, reached here, and I just think it's really important to get done. So with that, I'd yield back the balance of my time. And are there other members seeking recognition on the minority side? Are there other members on the Republican side seeking recognition? Seeing none. The question now occurs on forwarding H.R. 1301 to the full committee. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say nay. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes have it. And the bill is favorably reported.
I think that's it. Is that it? That's Greg Walden, W7EQI. The only or one of the only hams in Congress. Yeah, I think that's it. All right. So you probably came upon your favorite thing to not be happy with, among the many things that were said there. Greg, 2-meter antenna is 19 inches tall, not a foot, but let's not quibble. But there are plenty of other things that, you know, here and there that you might quibble with. But the big thing that is going to make a big difference sometime down the road, maybe not too long down the road, is the amendments thing. That's kind of new, or at least I think it's kind of new. I'm going to have more to say about that, quite a bit more to say about that a little bit later on in the program. But first, I want to spend some time getting us to this point, because other things went on. There was the hearing last January 10th, and there was a little bit of activity yesterday. So I got some video from all those things. But first, well, speaking of all parity all the time, Christian Kudnick, you were saying what on Monday?
But that's all I have for this week, Katie. We've got a lot of interesting guests coming up, and I've been reaching out to some people.
Oh, good.
Of course.
We like guests.
We have to talk about this parity thing some more. I really want to get a broad stroke. There was a lot of it at one time that was kind of flooding the ham radio podcast or shows, and I was like, right. Oh, man, I really just want a simple breakdown. And then tell our audience what to do. Go and help. This is your role. Go do that. And there's people to talk to. There's a mirror parity bill act happening here in Missouri that's trying to get off. There's people here struggling just like everywhere else. So there's a lot going on. And I think maybe it's certainly worth us investing some time into that whole deal. It's kind of complicated, but if we can simplify it, it'll be good. And
yep.
And some other things. I'd like to get the new league president to come in.
Yeah.
Rick Roderick.
Okay, so would I. If I were down in Orlando, I'd be beating on him, but I'm not. I'm sitting here recovering from that flu thing that I had day before yesterday, kind of getting better yesterday. You can probably, you know, I'm still kind of fuzzy-throated, not as deep and resonant as I like to be, but that's what happens at the end of a cold and at the end of a little flu-ish stuff. So, you know, tomorrow's Friday morning as I record this. They're late Thursday night. And I'd be about healthy enough to be there, but the packing and traveling, you know, kind of got in the way. So anyway, I get a chance to sit here and do this. So, Christian, K-Zero Shake the House. Flooding the podcasts? I don't know. I think most of the other shows did headlines on it as things have progressed. The ARL has spent a lot of time on it, but they don't do a podcast. They put out some videos now and then. But I think, you know, here at Ham Radio Now, we're the only people, I'm the only person that has done extensive coverage, you know, to the boredom, perhaps, of some people in the audience, extensive coverage of the Parity Act. And by the way, Christian, you can say it. Ham Radio Now. other podcast. Say it. Say it. Go ahead and say it. I'm doing that because I just saw a rerun episode of one of my favorite shows.
Say it. Say it. I'm annoying. Say it.
Is it one of your favorite shows? Big Bang Theory? Among, you know, techie, nerdy, engineering type people, there is divided sentiment on Big Bang Theory. A lot of us like it. Some people don't. You know, we understand, yeah, they're making fun of us, but very loving fun. Anyway, excuse me, I'll grant that, well, here on Ham Radio Now, and the people that I've talked to from the league, we have attempted to do those simple instructions. Here are the simple things that you need to do. But it's always been embedded in a program that's got lots more detail. And it's usually not right up front where you could find it right away. So do the simple one. Let's see how you do. And say it. Ham Radio Now, say it.
You're annoying.
Katie might say it. Katie loves me. What have I done? Messed up my Evernote script. There we go. We're back. All right. Let's get down to business. First, the Energy and Commerce Committee of the House of Representatives has changed their website. And where are they? Up here. So we've seen, every time I've shown this to you, we've seen something different. This is what it looks like now. So anything you've seen on the program before about how to go find a video or something live, forget it, because it has changed. But it's perhaps, at least in some ways, become a lot easier. All of their video is now basically on YouTube. It had been on YouTube, but they were trying to make it look like that it was not, that it was on their own site or something, but it was really on YouTube. And so all you got to do is go here, the little YouTube thing. Let's do that. Get my head out of the way. And there's all their videos. If you were to see my edited video, I don't get it. If you were to see something live going on, then there'd be a window here that says live now. And you could just click on it and look. That's where I got the stuff that I was just showing you. If you look at the history of the videos, I think that's the one that I was playing. That's power. We're looking at, we go Subcom Tech, the Subcommittee on Communications and Technology reconvenes for the markup of HR 2666, HR 1301. So yeah, that's the one that I was looking at. I've learned something. I think I may have explained this already. I think with the episode with Larry on, the parity bill in Missouri. By the way, Larry says Missouri. Christian Kudnick, Kaiser O'Shake the House, says Missouri. They live there. I'm going back to Missouri. I think Missouri is a little bit affected for somebody who grew up in Chicago and now lives in North Carolina. Missouri. I may do Missouri now and then. What do you guys in Missouri want? Show me. All right. You may also find old links to some of the House committee, subcommittee stuff have broken. If I placed links somewhere or other people have placed links to find video, it may lead to nowhere because they changed too much stuff. And I was noticing on the league website that that their link was broken, and now they fixed it. And by the way, the league has, have we got the league up here? Yeah. They've got their story up on this favorable subcommittee thing. Do they make a deal out of, looking to see if they made a deal out of the upcoming amendments? Well, Representative Anna Eshoo from California is the lead proponent on the committee for the Homeowners Association's stuff. But it doesn't really say amendments here, if I'm reading it correctly. Amendments. They're not saying it. I don't know if they're deliberately soft pedaling it or just they just didn't get it. But I got it. I think you probably got it. So once again, there could be some broken links here and there. Now you know where to go. Let's go back to January, where the foundation was laid for the vote that we saw today. And there's it was a long hearing. I had learned the difference between a hearing and a markup. Because in the program that I did about the hearing, I said several times that the hearing was going to be important. I guess this was the program I did just before the hearing, that it was going to be very important because when they took a vote, which they didn't do, when they took a vote, if it passed, it moves on. If it didn't pass, it was dead. Dead everywhere. It didn't matter if there was a Senate bill, because there has to be a bill in the House and in the Senate. And so if it didn't pass this subcommittee, it was going to die. Well, of course, a vote did not happen then, because that's not what that meeting was for. That meeting was to set up this, or that hearing was to set up this session, a markup session, and that's their language. If I'd been a good poli-sci student back in college or even high school, I'd maybe remember that. I'm sure that language has been around since the 1800s sometime, that a markup session is when they vote. Because, you know, you can't blame them. We've got so much language in ham radio where things mean different things than you might expect them to. So they got their own language. It was a markup session. So going back to the hearing then, I've got a bunch of video from that. And most of these are pretty quick. A few of them take a little bit longer. Let me start with Representative Greg Walden, Republican from Oregon, W7EQI. He's the chairman of the Subcommittee on Communications and Technology. Good choice. Picked a ham. And he made some opening comments as he got the session going. So, Greg.
Second, we will examine H.R. 1301. This is the Amateur Radio Parity Act of 2015. As a ham radio operator, and perhaps one of the only in Congress, I'm acutely aware of the passion that amateur radio operators have for their service. Despite its widespread use and importance in times of emergency, some land use restrictions in some areas have prioritized aesthetics over the rights of hams. H.R. 1301 seeks to ensure that amateur radio operators get a fair shake and protection from unnecessary bans on their equipment by instructing the FCC to adopt rules to this end. Now, I know some have said this is opening the door to 40-foot towers in townhome backyards. That's not the case. Ham equipment can be as small as over-the-air digital television antenna that are becoming popular with cord cutters. Surely ham radio operators' communications deserve no less protection than access to primetime television. This is a common-sense bill, and I urge my colleagues to support it.
Okay. So that's the lead-in, and once again, a few things that you might take a little issue with. I don't think it's a good lead-off to say ham radio antennas can be the size of the little satellite dishes. And 40-foot towers? No, we want 70-foot towers. Actually, hearkening back to a program I did with Fred Baumgartner? Was that his name? Sorry. It was on that antenna case in Ohio, Gary Wadke's antenna case, which he finally won. And the advice was, don't put a height limit on anything in any of this. Reasonable accommodation, minimum practical regulation, doesn't need a height limit. That stuff gets figured out in the accommodation phase of things on an individual basis. So watch out for those height limits. Introduced into the record in that subcommittee hearing were two letters from witnesses who did not appear in live testimony, but interested parties that provided commentary. One was Chris Imlay, W3KD from the ARL. He read in He had entered and written the league's comments for that hearing. The other, and I think you'll hear this name mentioned, I think, coming up, is Thomas Skiba, the chief executive officer from a group called CAI, the Community Associations Institute. It's the umbrella group, it's the ARL of community associations. And stay tuned for more on that. I'll talk about that in some detail. I didn't finish reading it until yesterday. I don't think I was the only one. As you'll hear from more comments about amendments in yesterday's talk and this morning's, they had said that they didn't have time to enter the amendments information into the language for this markup. So they passed the bill as written with the intention of making changes to it, making amendments to it, working together to create amendments as it arrives in the main committee, the Energy and Commerce Committee. And they said they didn't have time to get that prepared. Well, this stuff has been around since January 10th at the latest, because the information entered into the record from the CAI will have amendments suggested. And I'm assuming that's going to be the basis for the amendments that are going to be at least negotiated. Well, I'll go through those amendments in a little bit. But let's get back to the February 10th. No, that's yesterday. That's late. I'm sick. Let's get back to the January 10th hearing and listen to a couple more statements. This is Representative Anna Eshoo from California, and she's the one that is expressing concern about the Amateur Radio Parity Act.
Third, while I've been a longtime supporter of amateur radio operators, including you, Mr. Chairman, and the services that they provide, and I have a lot in my district, I do have some concerns with the Amateur Radio Parity Act. As written, the legislation could violate the rights of homeowners associations, and that's who I've heard from. So I think, again, we've got to take a look at this and make sure that we can blend the underlying purpose of this and not stick it to the homeowners associations, the HOAs in the country, by overruling covenants and easements that are conveyed with the purchase of a property from one seller to another. And I'm proud to be a co-sponsor.
Not a co-sponsor of the Parity Act. Co-sponsor or something else. She was moving on to something else. Yeah, I found the comments on the letters that have been my co-host, the mouse. There she is doing her very best to get herself completely wrapped around my headphone cord. Go back there, mouse. An editorial comment on the program from the mouse. Okay, so I found the comments. Did I find them? Here they are. Let's listen to that.
I ask unanimous consent now to enter into the record a letter from Mr. Chris Imlay, General Counsel of the Amateur Radio Relay League, expressing support for the Amateur Radio Parity Act, as well as a letter from Mr. Thomas Skiba, CEO of the Community Associations Institute, suggesting changes to the legislation from the perspective of homeowners and community associations. Without objection. I also want to thank both the ARRL and CAI for their comments on this legislation, and we look forward to working with them and with the ranking member as we advance this important legislation.
Okay, so entered those letters. And again, I'll get to the, especially the CAI's letter. I don't think I've even read the ARRL's. I haven't done all of my homework. Okay, next, Representative Robert Latta, the Republican from Ohio. Most of this hearing dealt with four issues, three of them pretty big and commercial, and one, the Ham Radio Parity Act. So we didn't get a lot of attention there, and most of the representatives and none of the live witnesses talked about ham radio at all. Well, one of them did, just a little bit. We'll see what that was. But first, Representative Robert Latta from Ohio, he at least touched briefly on the Parity Act as he made his remarks.
All four bills before us today are good legislative measures that will limit unnecessary government regulations and protect consumers. I'd like to focus my time on the two bills that stem from the FCC's decision to reclassify broadband as a telecommunications service under Title II.
Okay, so he didn't mention it. He just said they're good bills that he remove excessive government regulation. That's going to be a bit of a sticky thing, too. Not because he said it, but you know, it's something that people will be concerned about. Okay, here's one of the witnesses. It's Robert McDowell. He's a former FCC commissioner, and he's got something to say about amateur radio and Greg Walden's license.
There's a lot more to discuss. I do support the other two bills and look forward to a robust, in-depth discussion of amateur radio. In 7 years as an FCC commissioner, I think I spent maybe 10 minutes on amateur radio, but I think five of them are renewing your license, Mr. Chairman.
So, I'm glad you took a personal interest in it.
Yes. So I look forward to discussing it. Thank you again.
At least I didn't have to take the code test again. We'll now go to Mr. Feld, public knowledge.
Yeah, good on you, Greg. So maybe a little distressed that a former FCC commissioner in the years that he spent on the commission spent, 12 minutes, did he say, on AM radio? It was an off-the-cuff remark, but you know, says a little bit about where we rate in the greater scheme of things. You knew that. The congressman who introduced the Parity Act is Adam Kinzinger, a Republican from Illinois, and he makes, as you might expect, since he was the original sponsor of the bill, he makes some longer comments and, something that I think you're generally going to be pleased with. So let's check that out.
Chair recognizes Mr. Kinzinger.
Thank you, Chairman, and thanks to the folks here, and thank you for holding this hearing to the committee. I want to just talk about a couple of the bills I introduced, 2666 and 1301. The Amateur Parity Radio Act has over 100 bipartisan co-sponsors, including the chairman. And as a point of interest, every member of Congress throughout the country has at least a few hundred licensed amateur radio operators in their district. Under current law and regulation in certain areas, ham radios are outright prohibited from placing any form of antenna on their home. Even those as small as a 4-millimeter diameter wire that would run under an awning or flat against a house. For some, this is merely a nuisance, but for others, those that go through additional training and certification to become an emergency communications volunteer, this can be dangerous. During the times of emergency, like a hurricane or a tornado, amateur radio operators are able to use their skills and equipment to create a network of communications for first responders when all other networks have failed. And as a point of interest, as a military pilot, there were a number of times overseas where we would actually use phone patches and pass coded messages through ham radio operators to our command post. And so I think that's very interesting to note that they serve that purpose too. And a quick summary from the FEMA director, Mr. Fugate, I guess, I don't know if I said his name right, on the issue. He said, quote, "I think that there's a tendency to believe that we have done so much to build infrastructure and resiliency in all of our other systems. When everything else fails, amateur radio oftentimes is our last line of defense. When you need amateur radio, you really need them." And I think this is very important. HR 1301 would change some of these issues by implementing a reasonable accommodation standard. There's no mandate on the placement, size, aesthetics, as those decisions are left to the discussion to take place between ham radio operators and their jurisdictions. We just simply add the same standard that's been used successfully in municipal areas to other areas. Switching gears, the rate regulation bill comes about as a result of comments and statements made by the president.
And he's off to one of the other issues for the hearing. Craig Fugate, the FEMA chairman. So, Craig Fugate. Sorry, he's a ham too. Okay, so that's that was the hearing back in January. As things got introduced, it was not the markup. It's not where they voted. Today is when they voted. But yesterday, for some reason, they split this in two. Maybe there was a governmental technical reason for starting things yesterday and finishing them this morning. But yesterday went quick. today went quick. You saw all of today's at the beginning of the program. But at least it's worth it. I think worth looking at this stuff because we don't see ham radio in this venue very often. And the league doesn't put up video of it, or at least don't dig it out and make it really obvious. They don't stick links to it and stuff in there. I guess they do. They put links to it in some of their news stories, but they don't splash it all over the page. So let's take a look at it. I'm trying to justify my spending the time looking at this stuff. I think it's fascinating. I think probably you do too. So here we go to February 10th. That is yesterday. And Greg Walden will, by the way, I want to apologize for the widescreen image that should be an ordinary standard definition narrow screen. That's the way they sent it. And you could see from this morning's that they fixed it. But back in January, they were sending out the wrong aspect ratio to YouTube. And that's what we got. I could change it, but I'm not going to spend the time. There's way too much effort already involved in putting this program together. And now to yesterday, and Greg opens the session that sort of introduces this session.
Subcommittee is going to come to order. We're going to go ahead and start this process with opening statements, and hopefully our members will join us. But we are 15 minutes after the scheduled start time. And I'm going to start with my own opening comments here. Today we're considering three bills intended to benefit consumers, improve access to communications, and protect small businesses from burdensome regulations. Last month we held a legislative hearing on these bills where we heard from the witnesses who provided us with valuable feedback and suggestions for improving our legislation. In the time since that hearing, we've continued to work with our colleagues to focus on changes to the bills that achieve our goals and hopefully garner bipartisan support. The first bill we'll take up today is H.R. 1301, the Amateur Radio Parity Act of 2015. Now, this bill puts into place common sense reforms that ensure that ham radio operators have the opportunity to place unobtrusive equipment on their home property. As a ham radio operator myself, I know firsthand both the passion that operators have for this service, as well as how valuable they are, especially in times of emergency. While we're seeking to protect ham operators' ability to put up antennas, we also recognize that there's a role for community associations in preserving the interests of their residents. To that end, we've been working closely with stakeholders and our colleagues on the other side of the aisle to come to an agreement on language that achieves both of these goals. While the bill we will vote on today is the original language, we're still negotiating and we intend to find a compromise before we move the bill to full committee markup. Next, we'll consider H.R. 2666. Now, this legislation prohibits the FCC from regulating the rates of broadband.
Okay, so once again, he talks about the compromise. Yeah, okay, that's it. He talks about the compromise. The bill will be amended and changed. And I'll talk about a little bit about that in a little bit. Nothing that's really been discussed out there in ham radio land so far. Until now, you're on ham radio now. Next is Robert Latta's comments. He is not going to talk about the bill particularly, but he'll have something to say that is kind of important to listen to. So this is Representative Latta.
I don't see anybody on the other side of the aisle, so we'll now go to the vice chair of the subcommittee, Mr. Latta, for opening comments.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you very much for holding today's hearing. I am pleased that we're considering several legislative measures that will limit unnecessary government regulations and protect the public. I would like to focus on the two bills that stem from the FCC's decision to reclassify broadband as a telecommunications service under Title II of the Communications Act.
Yeah, so what he says is considering bills that will limit unnecessary government regulation. The CAI considers the Parity Act, House Bill 1301, to be unnecessary government regulation. So, cross purposes there. I know I'm not supposed to point things out like that. It's not my job to not point things out like that. I'm not the spin doctor. I'm the truth-telling Swami. Okay, so let's get this thing on the record. Would the clerk please read it into the record, please? Clerk, please.
Let's see here. I don't see any other members seeking to make opening statements. And so the chair calls up H.R. 1301 and asks the clerk to report.
H.R. 1301, to direct the Federal Communications Commission to extend to private land use restrictions its rule relating to reasonable accommodation of amateur service communications.
Without objection, the first reading of the bill is dispensed with. The bill will be open for amendment at any point, so ordered. We are now on H.R. 1301. The subcommittee will reconvene at 10 o'clock tomorrow, and I remind members the chair will give priority recognition to bipartisan amendments, and I look forward to seeing all of you and perhaps a few more members tomorrow, including members on the other side. Without objection, the subcommittee stands in recess.
Bam. Okay, so the subcommittee stands in recess. He was commenting with an occasional bit of snark that there weren't any Democrats there at that yesterday's version of the hearing. And you've seen this morning, so you've seen the whole thing. You've seen everything I got here on that. They did talk about amendments. Expect it to be amended. But what might they be? And you remember that submission on the record by the CAI back in January. Nobody, including me, apparently nobody on the subcommittee, actually read that until yesterday. Sorry, CAI. There's lots of interesting stuff in it. I don't have time for all of it, but it did spell out seven specific requests for amendments. Some of them not too bad. Some of them maybe deal breakers. So for now, that document is our best clue to what might be in those amendments. And it's been around since January 10th, at least. We should do our homework. Let's take a look. I got a PDF of their comments. Okay, so this is from Thomas Skiba, the CAE. Oh, he's a CAE, whatever that is. The Chief Executive Officer of the Community Associations Institute. It's the statement for the record, dated January 12, 2016. And I'm reading this for you in part for clarity and in part for the audio audience, folks that don't get to see the pictures of all this. There's a bunch of stuff in here. It's about a 12-page document. A lot of just boilerplate and in who we are and stuff like that. The CAI is the only nationwide membership organization dedicated to the community association model of home ownership. Their, you know, kind of spinish blah, blah, blah language. CAI members are homeowners, association board members, managing agents, and business partners. So there are homeowners involved. I don't know how many, but there are homeowners involved. An important point there, because they're going to, they've done some survey stuff, and they claim to have a lot of information based on feedback based on homeowners people that pretty much says they don't like this thing. I made a lot of notes in this that I really don't have time for because time is slipping away for this program. I don't want it to be a four-hour program. But something about this one I want to point out, and I'll point it out slightly snarkily, because they're saying that they did a survey on satisfaction with community associations, and only 64% of their survey really liked them, and 26% was neutral. So, you know, they spin it the best they can. 90% of homeowners rated the experience. I hope you stop thinking after the 90%. Positive, 64%. Neutral, 26%. So, okay. Again, lots of stuff in here. All this stuff I outlined in yellow was stuff I thought was important. Let's see. And this is not, my goal was not to argue every point that they make, just to point out some of them. You can get this. In fact, I'll put my marked up version on the Ham Radio Now website in the show notes when I get around to making it. You know, I'm a little behind. I'm back at episode 240, what, one or two? This is 245. I'll get them done probably tomorrow. I'll try. So where was I here? Oh, okay. this is something that goes over and over and over again. Restrictive covenants are contractual agreements between private parties. They are not generally a matter of concern to the commission. They're quoting the commission from back in 1985. Such agreements are voluntarily entered into by the buyer or tenant when the agreement is executed and usually do not concern this commission. So my comment, and again, I'm not trying to make a comment on everything that they've said, but for some reason, that's the button I wanted to push. For some reason, I felt it was worth putting in a note here that the commission made that comment in 1985, and it might have been fairly true in 1985. But today, a buyer or tenant, if they are voluntarily entering into this contract, and it's something that we're trying to say is not really the case anymore, it is not a choice on their part, because finding housing that is not covered by these contracts, and that's the only other option, buy or don't, no negotiation at the purchase point. Finding alternative locations is difficult. It greatly restricts the options that you have for where you can buy a house. If you say, I will not participate in one of these, you're going to be in a rural territory, a very old neighborhood, or one of very few newer neighborhoods that doesn't include a homeowners association. So my impression as I went through all of this, and you can make your own, is that they did some cherry picking of facts and what the FCC said. They weren't terrible about it. I've seen very much worse spinning and cherry picking. But they did put this in the most positive view that they can. And as you read it, you can sort of start saying, it's hopeless. They've got great arguments. Well, they have some good arguments, but we have good reputation. And I can't make this program all about all of that, or we will be here until midnight. No matter when you started it, we would be here until midnight. So let me get on to the amendments. This is the suggested amendments for HR 1301. So this is what they would like to see things change. Seven of them, six on this page. Number one, prior notice from an amateur service licensee of intent to install an external tower, antenna, or other apparatus necessary for carrying on amateur radio service communications. I don't think that would give us a whole lot of heartburn. I am not the lawyer. I can't interpret this for you in any legal fashion. As a lay person of moderate intelligence, it reads to me like you can't just put up the tower and say, PRB1 and the Parity Act, stick it. You got to let them know in advance. Okay, so maybe not so bad. This next one is a little complicated to read. The association authority to enjoin installation of any antenna, tower, or other apparatus necessary for carrying on amateur service communications on commonly owned property or property maintained by the association. So what they're asking there is that the act be amended so that the association can say, okay, we got to talk to you about putting up an antenna, but we can say no about putting it on common property. Anything that's owned commonly by everybody, that territory is off limits. If you've got an argument about that, I don't know what it is. You in the audience, ham radio operators, there may be a good argument about it. I don't know what it is. The fact that I don't know what it is doesn't mean there isn't a good one. So let's see. Number three, the association authority to establish written rules concerning safety, height, location, size, and installation requirements for external antennas, towers, or other apparatus necessary for carrying on amateur radio service communications. And that one may be something of a deal breaker. We don't like the idea of a specified height, not necessarily location, certainly not size, maybe installation requirements, but installation requirements should be along the lines of recognized safety, things like that. So this is a little too broad. I expect this is one that, at least I hope, that the folks doing the negotiating in the committees will not accept it at face value and beat it back significantly. Expect down in Orlando, they're going to be talking about these things a lot. At least I hope they are. I hope that they've got this list and they're looking at it. And if they don't, and you see this program, you're not going to see it until Friday is done. So maybe on Saturday, bring it up at the banquet. Note that this list is there, and I'm sure they know all about it. I'm sure they do. So anyway, moving on. Number four, accommodation of interest of all homeowners and residents, including those of amateur licensees, in establishment of any written rule related to, but not limited to, site easements, interference with air, light, and open space, or the permitted height of principal structures in relation to external antennas, towers, and other apparatus necessary for carrying on amateur radio communications. Send in the lawyers. I don't understand that very well at all. Maybe I need to read it five or six more times when I'm a little bit more awake. But I'm going to have that one explained to me. Direction, direction that an association may not adopt and enforce written rules that by intent or effect preclude amateur service communications. That seems to be on our side, if there's sides. If this is lining up sides, and I'm afraid it kind of is. Basically says they can't adopt rules that preclude amateur service communications. So the stuff above, like number three, all the rules concerning height, safety, location, size, installation requirements, can't say no. But it may make things not too practical. Remember the part in PRB 1 and the part in the Parity Act that says the minimum practicable regulation. And some of this may not be the minimum practicable. I think they may be trying to argue their way out of minimum practicable. Don't hear those words too often. In fact, in the whole show that I did with Larry on Parity in Missouri, we talked about reasonable accommodation a lot, and I realized in watching that program that we didn't say minimum practicable nearly enough, maybe not at all. Number six, construction or modification of a structure must be in compliance with all applicable building codes and engineering standards. I think that's shouldn't be a problem for us. Shouldn't be. Number seven, the licensee must provide proof of appropriate risk coverage for all external devices and structures. And once again, there may be more hiding behind that than I'm aware of. It seems like if you're going to have all that stuff, you need to have insurance on it for safety, for eventualities, should something fail and it cause damage or injury or whatever. You should be insured for that. Okay, so expect more to be coming of that. We don't know when it's going to appear before the full House committee. Greg Walden wanted it to be soon. In letting it go, his ability to control things is probably diminished. But you know, he's a member of the bigger committee, and you know, he can still rant and rail, and he's in the, you know, the Republican, he's in the party in power. So if it was a Democrat, at this point, they're, you know, pretty powerless till, you know, whenever things change, if they ever do. A couple questions here. Is this amendment thing going to be an issue for the Senate bill? Yes. Yeah. The Senate and House bills have to be reconciled at the very least, at the very end. Both chambers have to pass identical bills, so it might slow things down. It could slow things down to the point that it misses the end of the year deadline. And this year is the hard deadline. I know I screwed it up last year, thinking the session only lasted 1 year, and it's moved on to it's a 2 year session. The bill has 2 years of life. It's only February. We got to the end of this year. But if it goes toward the end of the year and things haven't been reconciled, that could be a problem. Yeah. I expect the Senate will be lobbied for amendments before that. I expect that the Senate will be lobbied for any CAI, I knew I was going to do that, CAI amendments that the House rejects. If the House turns them down, that go to the Senate, beat on the Senate, get somebody to get the amendments in on that side. And once again, they got to go back to the reconciliation. So we will see. Is it going to affect the Missouri bill? Probably not. They're not identical now. They're similar, but they're not identical. The Missouri bill will be amended. Something extra interesting, and it didn't really get to point it out very much as we looked through the CAI's document, but a lot of their objection to 1301 is that it is a federal issue that deals with things that should be decided by the state and local governments. So the Missouri bill is a state bill. And that, I mean, the CAI could then say, well, what we really mean was local. But they said state and local. And I think state is local enough that it's going to take the edge off of any complaints they have in that regard. Turn the sound on and at least save you from listening to that. Speaking of the Missouri Parity Act and that off-the-record objection, remember that? Parity in Missouri? My voice is coming back a little bit. Well, I was copied on email from the ARRL General Counsel, Chris Emley, W3KD, that he sent to Larry Scantlin, KE0KZ, my guest on that program and the guy that got the Missouri bill started and has done most of the legwork for keeping it moving. In Chris's email, the league's problem with the program was that it might appear that Larry and I were saying that the league officially endorsed or endorses the effort to get a state parity act bill enacted in Missouri. And that word endorsed is important here. Chris wrote, neither Dan nor I, Chris, have the authority to bind ARRL to anything. Well, I, Chris, do think the Missouri legislation is consistent with our federal legislative effort. That would be a determination properly made by the ARRL Board of Directors or our executive committee. That has not happened. I apologize. I'm not professional enough to stick exactly within the quotes. I added a word or two here or there. I didn't change the meaning. But that's what Chris said. So let me see if I can muddy this up a little bit. The league did help Larry and his associates prepare to have this bill introduced in the Missouri House. Dan Henderson at N3ND, Chris Imlay, and Cecil Higgins, AC4HA, all provided assistance. And Dan is headquarters staff. Chris is the league general counsel. Cecil is the Missouri section manager. Ward Silver, N0AX, also testified at the hearing in Missouri. He's a league contractor. He's edited several books, including the handbook. He writes QSD column. I would say Ward was not participating on behalf of the league. He was not representing the league. He was representing himself. So I'm not too worried about him. All that happened was all above board. No one is denying it. The rub is that Chris Emley believes that the program, and maybe some other things that that Larry has said, leave the impression, or does it categorically state that the league, screwed that one up, does it categorically state that the league endorses the effort? Did we say that? Did we even leave that strong impression? Well, let's clear it up. They do not. They provided assistance. They will provide assistance again if it's needed. Only the ARRL Board of Directors or the Executive Committee can make an endorsement, and they have not done that. So, is that it? Is that the part that the off-the-record comment says was not completely true? I don't know. The off-the-record part of the conversation didn't get that specific on the caller's complaints. I can't really say what was there. So I said it was off the record, in part because at this point it's fading from memory. I didn't record it, didn't make specific notes afterwards, but it didn't address those specific complaints. So, the league has now responded. One could not assume that that is the source of the off-the-record conversation, because I can't say what the source of the off-record conversation would be. If you want to speculate about that, feel free. Knock yourself out. The heck is that noise? I don't know. Just went away. There's not a soundproof studio. There is activity in the house. All right. Chris also requested in his letter that Ham Radio Now, he said, Mr. Pierce, delete from his webcast on this topic any reference to individual endorsements by Dan or myself. They are completely inappropriate. So Chris wants me to delete those pieces from the program. He has requested it. He didn't demand it. He didn't send a cease and desist. He just asked nicely. And before I answer, a short story. And Chris, this won't come as any surprise. In the live broadcast business, and I've been in the live broadcast business on and off now and then, I have had requests for changes after a program aired. And we finished the live program and someone says, can we change that? And I say, sure. The program is now just about passing Jupiter. Let's rush out into space, chase it down, and make the changes. And so the folks in Alpha Centauri, when they get the program in 26 years, well, get the program you want. The folks here on Earth, though, they've already seen it. All right, well, this wasn't live. Yeah, I can edit the video. I could delete it. I could re-upload it to YouTube. There are some problems with that. YouTube doesn't accommodate just replacing a video. You do have to delete the original completely. The replacement becomes a brand new program with new view counts and new link URLs. Any links to the program out there on the web become broken, which may actually make Chris happy because he doesn't really want people to see it, but it doesn't make me happy. I think it was a good program. I want the links to lead people to watch the show. The audio version has been downloaded, you know, 1,000 times or so by now. And that's a Jupiter thing because there's no way to get those back. So no, I'm not going to edit or delete the program. I did put a note at the top of the YouTube show description, and I put an annotation text box over the video each time the ARL is referenced. Those are some YouTube tools. The annotations, unfortunately, don't show up on mobile devices, so the people who will see them are the people watching on PCs, but not on tablets or phones. More people watch on PCs, but there's still a lot of folks watching on tablets and phones. There's no tools for me to get to those people. I can't guarantee anyone reads the show descriptions. You click on the video and watch that. Some people do. Not a lot of people do. Okay, so I can't make it all go away, or at least I won't make it all go away, and I don't think I need to, because how much of a problem really is it? Well, to find out how much of a problem it is, I'm going to have to play every segment again from that program that mentions the ARL right here in this show, which is kind of the opposite of what Chris wanted. But this time we'll analyze them and we will dispel any impression that they may leave about an official league endorsement. Or we may discover that they didn't really leave much of an impression at all. So let me punch a few buttons here and clip one going. The first thing that I worry about something like this is, do we want lots of individual states coming up with their own act? And there's going to be some answers to that, but you did contact the league. You talked to Dan Henderson and Chris Imlay, and they all said, yeah. So not a problem, right? Yeah. All right. So let's take a look at the act itself. All right. So I asked. Asked and it was a court of law. Asked and answered. Did I contact the league? Yeah. And Larry kind of added, well, go for it. I kind of stepped on him. That's not an endorsement. He asked and go for it. But there's more. Let's take a look at clip number two. Did you at any point contact anybody at the league headquarters to ask for advice or help?
I did. In fact, I talked to Mr. Dave Henderson, N1ND at ARRL initially, even with respect to this issue. And he gave me the name of some attorneys that were part of their advisory council to contact to see if there might be someone here that could at least assist me in this process of getting the city to change the ordinance, which I did. I contacted one gentleman. I don't recall his call and name right now, but he was in Jefferson City, which is, of course, the capital of Missouri. And then I contacted one other. And basically, they were saying that, they felt like they'd had a case, but they weren't really, unless I was willing to hire them, they didn't really represent the hams in particular through the ARRL.
Yeah, so things seemed to be going well enough for you as you were working through this that you didn't think you needed to hire an attorney you didn't know at that point. Just talking about getting additional legal representation. Nothing in there about endorsement or anything like that. They just got assistance finding those people. Clip number three is talking about reasonable stuff. And I don't think it'll have a lot to do with endorsements, but it covers that reasonable thing where we don't talk very much about minimum practicable. So this is where I've got some heartburn about that. I think the hang-up, to some extent, that you pointed out is this concept of what's reasonable, because that's widely open to interpretation. And so your town thought, yeah, $150 in engineering studies and all that stuff is pretty reasonable. The ARRL should generally be able to provide precedent, case law and other decisions that have been rendered over the years since PRB1 came out back in the mid-80s that show that that sort of thing is not considered reasonable. But you know, it becomes tell it to the judge. You got to be willing to go to court if you want to go there, and you didn't have to get that far.
That's right, and I'd rather not have to do that. I mean, I was prepared to move that direction if we weren't going to get any resolution of the issue at the city level, at the board meeting level. But I felt pretty comfortable with the fact that I knew these board aldermen personally.
Okay, so once again, too much reasonable and not enough minimum practicable. Because that's... I wrote something cute here. That's the third leg of the PRB1 tower base, if you will. It's no prohibition, reasonable accommodation, minimum practicable regulation. So, and again, nothing in that clip that indicates that we thought that the ARL was endorsing the project. This clip, however, is a somewhat different story.
And then I discovered from conversations with Dan Henderson that Missouri had just elected a new section manager, Cecil Higgins. Dale Bagley, who was the previous section manager, had stepped down. And so I contacted Cecil Higgins, AC0HA, and brought him up to speed real quick on what was going on. Of course, he felt like he was kind of getting initiated by fire here in this process.
Welcome to the job.
Yeah, exactly. That was, it's in and other tasks as assigned, on his resume or in his job description. But he wanted to review the bill first. And of course, I think he wanted to contact the ARRL, make sure that they were sanctioning all this. And I might just step back for a moment and let you know that we did run this by Dan Henderson and general counsel, submitted the copy of this bill as when it was written up, and let them know what we were doing, and got them to contact the representative, Mr. Brian Spencer, and speak with him in person. Over the phone, of course, and give them, have that communication going on between ARRL and their experiences with the Parity Act currently, so that we would go into the state of Missouri legislature with good formulation of the bill and good ideas as to how we could overcome, objections.
So there is the tripwire word sanctioning, which is kind of the equivalent of endorsement. And he said that. Well, hold that thought. Clip five, I asked if Larry thought he was diluting the federal effort. And I'm putting this in because every time I mention anything about the ARL's effort, even remotely concerning the ARL, I wanted to get that in here. Doesn't really talk about ARL, but at least I think, if I recall correctly. Let's see if he says that. Do you get the sense that you may be diluting the federal effort or supporting it by getting more attention to both?
Well, I think the latter is true. I've spoken to a lot of amateurs, both on the air and by phone and email, who weren't that much aware of what was going on with H.R. 1301 of Senate 1685, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. And in many cases, they kind of said, well, that won't get anywhere. And I have given them the reason to believe that maybe they're wrong, that we can do things at the grassroots level, here at the local state level, that maybe will enhance what's going on at the federal level. Because the reality is, you know, these state representatives, a lot of them have ambitions to become U.S. representatives and state senators.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, like I said, no ARL reference there. And on the other hand, as I discussed a little bit earlier, the Missouri action may be actually quite positive because of the CAI's insistence that the Parity Act, the Federal Parity Act, is intrusive federal government regulation, and the Missouri Act is local. So we'll see. All right, here's my analysis. I have talked to Larry about this. I think we're kind of in agreement, although I may have had to twist his arm on a point or two. The league readily provided assistance from headquarters, from the general counsel, and from the section manager. So they all provided assistance. Okay. I think Larry could reasonably have concluded that the league supported the project. Now, Chris Imlay's letter requests that Larry retract any reference, let me quote this, retract any reference to support for the Missouri legislation, either by Dan Henderson or myself. While Dan and I did speak to and provide documents to Representative Brian Spencer, and we will be happy to continue to help the effort as best we can, we can't individually endorse the effort. End of quote. Okay, so I think Larry could have concluded that he had support, maybe not quite endorsement, but he can't say that now. So in the show, neither Larry and I use the word endorsement, but very casually, and I think that it's a clue to what Larry that Larry believed he did have league support. They use the word sanctioned. So the bottom line, I'm getting myself confused in what I wrote here. The bottom line, this is a non-issue that could have been handled better. The league has to guard its endorsements carefully. For them, it's an important legal technicality. And they could have just said that. Hey, Larry, we're glad to help and all, but we're not ready to endorse the project officially. Sorry if we left that impression. But as you refer to our role in the effort going forward, please just say that we provided assistance. That'll keep our lawyers happy. They can still say that. Okay, well, you know, Larry gets it. Yeah, he's a little bit stung. He said that being able to point to league support was a strong card to play. And I don't think that... that he was off base playing it, and he doesn't think he was off base playing it. He understands it's more of a technicality than a denial of what? I don't know. I can't say support, so I don't know. It is a technicality, but it's one that's important to the league. And I had something else that I wanted to put in here. Senator Wicker showed up on a Missouri radio station last year, making some interesting comments about ham radio. That'd be fun to listen to, but we've gone well over an hour, and I just need something for myself here right now. So, end of a parody. On to ham radio now. Fan Daniel Dion VE5DLD sent me this email just yesterday. He had sent a contribution, and I sent my note back that said, thank you very much for the contribution. I try to do that for everybody who sends one. I don't always succeed. Sometimes they actually pile up a little too much, and I've got too much to do, and I don't get to it before it kind of scrolls off the bottom of the screen. But I did send him a thanks, and he wrote back. He said that I didn't want to write a big message in that little PayPal comment box. When you make a contribution, there's a place that I ask for your call sign and say you can put a comment, but it's a little box, you know, about like that. And your text kind of goes through a ticker tape style. You can't expand it or anything. So some people do a pretty good job. Sorry, I'm dying here. Of putting an extensive comment in that box, but not a good place to do it. So I didn't want to write a big message in that little PayPal comment box, but I wanted to elaborate on my appreciation for your shows. Yeah, it's a humble brag here. I feel that you're filling a very important gap in amateur radio media. Many shows are more tailored to newer hams, like Ham Nation and 100 Watts on a Wire, and other shows are tailored to seasoned technical hams, like Solder Smoke. In my opinion, your show is well-tailored to hams with a few years' experience and excellent foundational knowledge of the hobby, but are far from being electrical engineers. You stay away from the basics, making a dipole, which I find is a waste of time as a media consumer and an experienced amateur. Oh, I hope he never discovers the dipole program. It's one of the earlier programs. Jeff and I and our wives had fun putting up a dipole at his house. We show people how to make them and things like that. Way different than anybody else's how to make a dipole program. So, Dan, if you watch that program, you might enjoy your first how to make a dipole program. You might. You might say, oh, my God, I had hopes for Gary, but they've been dashed on the sharp rocks of reality. Maybe he'll never do it again. I don't know. We will see. For that, I thank you. Stay away from the dipole programs. For that, I thank you in capital letters. Thank you. Your show engages my mind and provides me with a broader and deeper understanding of many topics in amateur radio. I love to get letters like this. I hate to get letters like this because they set the bar higher than I want it to be. Sometimes they can be hard to live up to. And then once again, I exceed my expectations. Your willingness to take risks and explore topics away from the mainstream keeps things fresh. And your ability to dig deeper into well-established topics provides a great service to amateur radio. Your shows are by far my favorites in amateur radio, as you do not insult my intelligence and help me be a better ham in knowing what is going on in my hobby. Keep up the excellent work. Other than the measly $30 Canadian, $20 American, darn exchange rate. Yeah, sorry about that. If you ever need a French to English translator or fact checker, it would be a pleasure for me to give you a hand, as I was raised as a French speaker.
Huh? Zut alors. Daniel, je parle français très bien.
Sort of. Actually, not so much. Just exhausted most of my French. 73, Daniel, VE5DLD. Thank you, Daniel. I needed that. Timing was just right. finally, apologies to Anthony Owen Ridlin, Jeff Burlington, Henry Graff, Dexter Muir, and a whole bunch of others who tossed me comments, mostly nice ones, every time I finish a show. You guys could very well be saying right now, hey, what are we, chopped liver? You never mentioned us before. Well, nope, it's timing. Daniel's email hit at just the right time. All right. I got to go finish getting weller, stop this cough. Wish I was in Orlando with you guys. I'm sure this Parity Act thing and the House hearing is going to be the talk of the town. You're going to hear a lot about it. And if you haven't, sign one of those letters. And I will see you next time. Ham Radio Now, brought to you by you, Arvin, sitting back there saying, you did better this time, Gary. You didn't make me too embarrassed to be associated with the program. Maybe somebody will send you a buck. You know, somebody like Daniel, good guy like that. So hamradionow.tv, thank you very much for those of you who have done that. And please, 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 for those of you that haven't yet. Goodbye. Over and out.